Good morning all. I am Dr. Usha Dandekar, Professor, Department of Anatomy, presenting a lecture on histology of salivary glands. We have studied gross anatomy of salivary glands like parotid glands, submandibular glands. So today we are going to study the histological features of these salivary glands. Now, salivary glands are accessory glands of secretion and they pour their secretion, that is the saliva, into the oral cavity. Now, what are the functions of salivary glands? The salivary glands, they secrete saliva, which contains water, mucus, proteins, salts, amylase, immunoglobulin A, and lactoperoxidase. And these secretions, they moisten the food. Then also, they lubricate and moisten the oral mucosa and lips, and they help in the digestion of the carbohydrates. Now, the salivary glands are broadly classified into two categories, the major salivary glands and minor salivary glands. Now, major salivary glands consist of parotid gland, submandibular gland and sublingual gland, while minor salivary glands are present in the mucous membrane of lips, cheeks, tongue, soft palate and epiglottis. Now if you see the structure of salivary gland, it is compound tubulo-alveolar or compound tubulo-acellar. Now what it means? Compound means the salivary gland, the duct system of the salivary gland is branching. So the duct, the main excretory duct of the salivary gland, it divides into many branches. So therefore it is called as compound. And if you see the secretory part of the gland, it is tubular as well as alveolar. Alveolar means the shape of the acinus is pear-like and therefore it is called as tubulo-alveolar. If the shape of the acinus is rounded, like in this acinus, it is called as acina. So structurally, the salivary gland is compound tubulo-alveolar or compound tubulo acinar glands. Now histologically, the salivary glands consist of two components and these are the stroma and parenchyma. Now stroma means it is a connective tissue component. The salivary gland is covered by a connective tissue capsule. And this capsule sends many septa within the gland. So in this picture you can see this is the connective tissue septa. So these are the connective tissue septa which are derived from the capsule. And these connective tissue septa divide the gland into many lobes and lobules. So stroma means connective tissue component. So, gland is surrounded by capsule, outside there is a capsule and this capsule sends many septa, connective tissue septa within the gland and divide the gland into many lobes and lobules. And these connective tissue septa, they carry the ducts and blood vessels along with them. So, these are the blood vessels. This is an arteriole, this is vein and this is the duct. So in the connective tissue septa, you can see the ducts and blood vessels. While parenchyma, it consists of lobes and lobules. And within the lobule, you can see multiple acini and ducts. So the parenchyma consists of acini and ducts, other ducts. So the salivary gland consists of two components, that is the stromal component, which is connective tissue, and the parenchymal component, which consists of acini and ducts. Now, what is acinus? Now, acinus, it is a group of secretory cells which are arranged around a narrow lumen, and these cells are surrounded by myoepithelial cells. So here you can see these are all acini. So concentrate this acinus. So it is a group of secretory cells which are arranged a narrow lumen. So here you can see a very narrow lumen, and this narrow lumen is surrounded by secretory cells. So in all acini you can see a lumen which is surrounded by secretory cells, and outside the cells you can see the myoepithelial cell. So this particular structure is called as acinus. So in this picture you can see these are all acini, and this acinus, it consists of a lumen in the center. So this is the lumen, and this lumen is surrounded by secretory cells. And if you take the cut section of this acinus, the picture is like this. So in the center there is a lumen which is surrounded by secretory cells, and this lumen of the acinus, it is continuous with the duct. Clear? So acinus is consists of secretory cells around a narrow lumen. Now, what are the types of acini? There are serous acini and mucous acini. And there are two types of acini: the serous acini and mucous acini. So in the salivary gland, you can see either serous acini or mucous acini. In some salivary glands, you can see the mixture of these two acini. That means there are serous acini as well as mucous acini. Then that gland is called as mucoserous or seromucous gland, or it is a mixed salivary gland. Okay. So depending on the type of acinus, you can classify it as serous salivary gland, mucous salivary gland, and mixed salivary gland. Now, what is the structure of serous acinus? Now, histologically, if you see a single acinus, this is a single acinus. The shape of the acinus is serous acinus. We are talking about the serous acinus. The shape of the acinus is rounded. Then if you see the lumen of the acinus, it is very narrow. So it has a narrow lumen, and this lumen is surrounded by secretory cells. Now these secretory cells are pyramidal in shape. Clear? So there is a narrow lumen, and this lumen is surrounded by pyramidal cells. Secretory cells are pyramidal in shape. Then the nucleus of these secretory cells is rounded, centrally placed, or sometimes it is towards the base. Then the cytoplasm of the cell is eosinophilic, it is darkly stained. Then in the cell you can see all cell organelles. For example, this is the schematic diagram of serous cell. In the basal portion you can see the rough endoplasmic reticulum. There is large number of rough endoplasmic reticulum. There are free ribosomes, and these two structures, they give basophilic appearance in the basal portion, while in the apical portion there are secretory granules, and these secretory granules are called as zymogen granules. And these zymogen granules, they take eosinophilic state. So in the apical portion you can see the eosinophilia, and in the basal portion there is basophilia. So serous acinus shows apical eosinophilia and basal basophilia. In addition to that, there are Golgi complex, mitochondria, lysosomes, microfilaments. Then another feature of serous acinus, serous cells, if you see the apical membrane, you can see the microvilli. So these are the microvilli in the apical membrane. Then the lumen of the serous acinus, it extends for a short distance between the two adjacent cells. So the lumen of the serous acinus extends for a short distance between the two adjacent cells, and this extension is called as intercellular canaliculus. Okay. So in serous acinus you can see intercellular canaliculi. Deep to the intercellular canaliculus there is a tight junction between the cell membranes of two adjacent cells, and deep to that the cell membrane shows folding which interdigitate with each other. So in serous acinus you can see the microvilli on the apical membrane, then intercellular canaliculus, tight junction and foldings of the cell membrane. Now what is the structure of mucous acinus? If you see the shape of the mucous acinus, it is tubular or tubulo-acinar. The lumen of the acinus is wide. So as compared to the serous acinus, the lumen of the mucous acinus is wide. Then the cells, if you see the cells of the acini, they are columnar in shape. Okay, then the nuclei are flat and they are situated at the base. So here you can see all the nuclei which are flat and they are situated, they are pushed peripherally and situated at the base. The cytoplasm of the cell is very light. It is lightly stained, and therefore the mucous acinus appears empty. The mucous cells appear empty. So it is very lightly stained. The cell organelles, regarding the cell organelles, the mucous acinus shows secretory vesicles and they contain the mucinogen granules in the apical portion. So in the apical portion there are mucinogen granules which secrete mucus. Then there are few rough endoplasmic reticulum, few ribosomes, then Golgi complex, mitochondria and lysosomes. Then in mucous acinus there are no microvilli on the apical membrane. As you can see in the serous acinus, there are microvilli on the apical membrane. Such microvilli are absent in the mucous acinus. Then intercellular canaliculus, then the tight junction foldings of the membrane are absent in the mucous alveolus. Now, what is serous demirinse? In case of mixed salivary gland, that means the gland which contains serous acini as well as mucous acini, you can see a peculiar structure, that is the serous demirinse. Now, what is serous demirinse? It consists of a mucous acinus. So, here you can see a mucous acinus, and this mucous acinus is capped by serous acinus. Okay, so there is a mucous acinus which is capped by cells of serous acini. So, this structure is called as serous demirinse. And this serous demirinse is seen in mixed salivary gland. Now, another peculiar structure of the salivary gland is myoepithelial cells. Now, myoepithelial cells are star-shaped cells, and they are situated around the acini. They are present between the acini cells and basal lamina, and these myoepithelial cells contain actin filaments, and because of the actin filaments, they are contractile in nature, and due to contraction of these myoepithelial cells, the secretion of the acini are squeezed up. Okay, so that is the function of the myoepithelial cells. The contraction of these myoepithelial cells squeezes the secretion of acini. Now, we have seen the acini in the parenchyma. In addition to the acini, there are ducts. Now, these ducts, the secretions of the acini are drained by the ducts into the oral cavity. Now, these ducts have branches. So, this is the main excretory duct, and it divides into, after entering into the gland, the main excretory duct divides into lobar ducts. Okay, so in the salivary gland there are many lobes. So main excretory duct divides into lobar ducts. So these are the lobar ducts. Now this lobar duct enters into the lobe. Now here this is one lobe. Now, after entering into the lobe, the lobar duct divides into interlobular duct. Okay, so these are interlobular duct. So, within the lobe, it divides into interlobular ducts. Now, these interlobular ducts, they pass through the connective tissue septa. Now, here in this picture, you can see this is the connective tissue septum, and this connective tissue septum carries the interlobular ducts. So, these are interlobular ducts. Now, these interlobular ducts, they further divide and redivide, and they enter into the lobules. So, within the lobe, there are many lobules. So, these are all lobules. And within the lobule, the duct divides into striated ducts. Okay. So, these striated ducts are seen within the lobule. So, here in this picture, you can see this is one lobule. And in the lobule, you can see a duct. Here this is the duct, Okay. So this duct is striated duct. Here again, this is the duct. This is the striated duct. So within the lobule, you can see the striated ducts. Now these striated ducts further divide into intercalated ducts. And intercalated ducts enter into the acinus. So here in this picture, very small duct. Here you can see a small duct. This is the intercalated duct. Here this is the intercalated duct. And this intercalated duct enters into the acinus. Okay. So whatever secretions of the acini are drained by the intercalated duct, then from the intercalated duct, the secretion is drained by the striated duct. Then from striated duct, the striated ducts join to form the interlobular duct, which is present in the connective tissue septa. Now interlobular ducts join to form the lobar duct, and many lobar ducts join to form the main excretory duct. And this main excretory duct enters into the oral cavity. So this is how the branching of the duct system. Now let us see the structure and lining epithelium of these ducts. Now this is the main excretory duct. This is larger in size. And it is lined by stratified cuboidal or stratified columnar epithelium. Now, lobar duct is also lined by stratified columnar or stratified cuboidal epithelium. And this lobar duct enters into the lobe. Then, within the lobe, there are interlobular ducts. And this interlobular duct runs through the connective tissue septa, and it is lined by pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium. So interlobular duct is lined by pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium. Then interlobular duct enters into the lobule, and within the lobule there are striated ducts. Now the structure of striated duct is slightly different from other ducts. These striated ducts show columnar cells. So it is lined by columnar cells, simple columnar cells. The nucleus is pushed in the apical portion, while in the basal portion there are striations. So these cells show striations in the basal portion, and therefore it is called as striated duct. And then the striated ducts divide to form the intercalated duct. It is the smallest duct, and it is lined by simple cuboidal epithelium or simple squamous epithelium. And this intercalated duct enters into the acinus. Now in this picture you can see the striated duct. Here this is the striated duct, which is lined by simple columnar epithelium, and at the basal portion you can see the striations. Now why these striations occur? Here one cell of the striated duct is shown. In the basal portion of the striated duct, in the basal, the single cell of the striated duct, the basal membrane shows folding, and the mitochondria are arranged vertically in these foldings. So the basal folding and the vertical arrangement of these mitochondria, they give striated appearance to the cell. And then The striated duct divides to form the intercalated duct. So this is the intercalated duct, which is lined by simple squamous epithelium or simple cuboidal epithelium, and it enters into the acinus. So this is the acinus. So we have seen the salivary gland consists of two main components, that is the stroma and parenchyma. Stroma is a connective tissue component and parenchyma consists of acini and ducts. So we have seen the different types of acini and we have seen the branching pattern of duct system. Now let us see the histology of major salivary glands. Now there are three major salivary glands: the parotid gland, submandibular gland, and sublingual gland. Now parotid gland, it is the largest salivary gland. It has a shape like inverted pyramid, and it is situated in the parotid region. Its excretory duct is called as Stenson's duct, and it opens in the vestibule of the mouth opposite upper second molar tooth. The secretion of the parotid gland is watery and it is rich in digestive enzymes. Now what is the histological features of parotid gland? Now parotid gland, it is a serous salivary gland. That means it consists of serous acini. Now it has two components, that is the stroma and parenchyma. Now stroma consists of capsule. That means it is covered by a capsule, and this capsule sends connective tissue septa within the gland and divide the gland into many lobes and lobules. So these are the connective tissue septa, and these connective tissue septa carry ducts and the blood vessels. So these are the interlobular ducts and these are the blood vessels. This is an arterial, this is venule. Then in the parenchyma, this is one lobule of the gland and it shows acini. So there are serous acini in the parotid gland. So you can see the serous acini, the lobule is filled with serous acini. We have seen the structure and the histological features of serous acini. Then these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells, which contracts and squeezes the secretion of the serous acini. Then there are ducts. Now within the lobule, you can see the striated ducts. So these are the striated ducts showing the basal striations. And then there are intercalated ducts, the smallest duct which enters into the acinus. So within the lobule you can see the striated ducts and intercalated ducts. In addition to that, you can see few adipose tissues. So here you can see the adipose tissue. These are adipose tissue. So parotid gland shows a capsule. This capsule sends connective tissue septa and divides the gland into many lobes and lobules. Then in the parenchyma, you can see the serous acini. With these serous acini surrounded by the myoepithelial cells. Then there are, within the lobule, there are striated ducts and intercalated duct. In addition to that, there are few adipose tissue. And within the connective tissue septa, you can see the blood vessels and interlobular ducts. The next gland is the submandibular gland. It is walnut in appearance, situated in the digastric triangle and lodges in the submandibular fossa of the mandible. Now, histologically, the submandibular gland is mixed type of gland. So, it is a mixed salivary gland. That means it consists of both acini, that is the serous acini and mucous acini. Now, similar to the parotid gland, submandibular gland consists of two components, that is the stroma and parenchyma. So, outside it is covered by a capsule, and the capsule sends septa within the gland, connective tissue septa. So, this is the connective tissue septa, and these connective tissue septa divide the gland into many lobes and lobules, and these connective tissue septa, they carry the ducts, the interlobular ducts, the blood vessels and nerves. Okay, so the connective tissue septa carries the ducts and the blood vessels. Then within the lobule, you can see the acini. So as it is mixed salivary gland, it consists of both acini, serous acini as well as mucous acini, but predominantly it consists of serous acini. So here, these are the darkly stained acini are all serous acini, while lightly stained acini are the mucous acini. So submandibular gland is a mixed salivary gland, but predominantly it consists of serous acini. Now these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells, and the peculiar feature of the submandibular gland or mixed salivary gland is serous demilune. Now here you can see the serous demilune. In this field, you can see a mucous acinus, and this mucous acinus is capped by serous acinus. So the serous acinus forms a crescentic cap over the mucous acinus. Now, here also you can see another serous demilune. The mucous acinus is capped by serous acinus. Now this serous demilune is not a true histological feature. Now what it means? Now this serous demilune is formed by routine fixation of the tissue. So due to routine fixation of the tissue by fixative, for example formaldehyde, this formaldehyde causes the swelling of the mucinogen granules which are present in the mucous acini, and due to the swelling of mucinogen granules, the mucous acinus gets swollen, and this mucous acinus compresses the serous acinus, the adjacent serous acinus, and therefore this serous acinus forms a crescentic cap over the mucous acinus. Another effect of this fixation is, if you see the nuclei of mucous acini, they are flattened, and this flattening of nuclei is due to the fixation. Due to the fixation, and that fixation causes the swelling of the mucinogen granules. And due to the swelling, these nuclei are pushed peripherally. So all nuclei of mucous acini are pushed peripherally. They are flat and they are pushed peripherally. So serous ganglions and the flattened nuclei which are situated peripherally, these are not true histological features. They are caused because of the routine fixation of the tissue. Now, in addition to the acini, there are ducts. Now, here you can see the striated duct. So, this is the striated duct. Then, the intercalated duct. This is the intercalated duct, which is the smallest duct. So, within the lobule, you can see the acini, the serous acini, as well as the mucous acini. Then these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells. In addition to that, you can see the serous ganglion, which is seen in the mixed salivary gland. Then you can see the striated ducts. Then there are intercalated ducts. Okay. And few adipose tissue in the parenchyma. So this is the feature of the histological feature of the submandibular gland. Then the next salivary gland is the sublingual gland. Now here this is the sublingual gland. It is smaller in size and situated in the floor of the mouth. Now what is the histological feature of the sublingual gland? The sublingual gland is covered by capsule, but this capsule is not well defined. Okay, so capsule is not well defined. There are connective tissue septa within the parenchyma, and these connective tissue septa divide the gland into many lobes and lobules. So here you can see the connective tissue septa, and this connective tissue septa carries the ducts and blood vessels. So these are the blood vessels. This is venule, this is arteriole, and this is the duct. So connective tissue septa carries the ducts. These ducts are the interlobular ducts and blood vessels. Now in the parenchyma you can see the acini. Now sublingual gland is a mixed salivary gland, but it consists of predominantly mucous acini. Remember, the submandibular gland is also a mixed salivary gland, but it consists of serous acini predominantly, while sublingual gland is also mixed salivary gland and it consists of mucous acini predominantly. So here these are all mucous acini and very few serous acini. The darkly stained acini are the serous acini and the lightly stained acini are the mucous acini. Then these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells. Then as it is a mixed salivary gland, you can see few serous demilunes. So here you can see serous ganglion. The mucous acinus is capped by serous acinus. Another serous ganglion is seen here. The mucous acinus is capped by serous acinus. So serous ganglions are seen in sublingual gland. Then in the parenchyma you can see the ducts. There are striated ducts. This is a striated duct. This is intercalated duct. But these striated ducts and intercalated ducts, they are very few or sometimes absent in the sublingual gland. You can see striated ducts and intercalated ducts in the parotid gland and submandibular gland, but in sublingual gland the striated ducts and intercalated ducts are very difficult to find out. Sometimes they are absent. And within the connective tissue septa, you can see the interlobular ducts. Then in addition to that, you can see few adipose tissue. Here you can see the adipose tissue. This is the adipose tissue. So sublingual gland is covered by capsule, but this capsule is ill-defined. And the capsule sends many septa, connective tissue septa within the gland. And these connective tissue septa carry ducts and blood vessels. Then in the parenchyma, you can see both acini, that is the mucous acini and serous acini, but predominantly mucous acini. Therefore, sublingual gland is also called as mucous salivary gland because it consists of large number of mucous acini. So these are the mucous acini, these are the serous acini, and these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells. Then you can see the serous demilune. Here you can see serous demilune. This is the mucous acinus which is surrounded by, which is capped by serous acinus. So this is serous demilune. Then ducts are very few. Striated ducts and the intercalated ducts are very few or sometimes absent in sublingual gland. And few adipose tissue are seen. Now, what are the differences between the serous acini and mucous acini? Now, here this is the serous acini and these are the mucous acini. If you see the structure of serous acini, it is tubuloacini, while the mucous acini are compound tubular or compound tubuloacini. Here it is compound tubuloacini. The mucous acini are compound tubular or compound tubuloacini. Then the serous acini are smaller in size while mucous acini are larger in size. The serous acini are rounded in shape, while mucous acini are tubular or rounded. Then histologically, if you see the differences, this is the serous acinus and this is the mucous acinus. Now serous acinus has a narrow lumen, while mucous acinus has a wide lumen. Then this lumen is surrounded by secretory cells. So these are the secretory cells, and the shape of the secretory cell in case of serous acinus is pyramidal, while in case of mucous acinus, the secretory cells are columnar. The serous acinus is darkly stained, it is darkly eosinophilic. While mucous acinus is very lightly stained, sometimes it appears empty. Then nucleus of the serous cell is rounded and it is centrally placed or towards the base. While in case of mucous acinus, the nucleus is flat and it is pushed peripherally. Then the serous cells contain zymogen granules in the apical portion, while in mucous cell there are mucinogen granules in the apical portion. Due to the zymogen granules, there is apical eosinophilia, and in the basal portion, there are large number of rough endoplasmic reticulum. Therefore, there is basophilia. So, in serous acini, you can see the apical eosinophilia and basal basophilia. Such apical eosinophilia and basal basophilia is absent in mucous acini. Then, the serous demilids are formed in case of mixed salivary gland, but mucous demilids are not formed. Then if you see the electron microscopic picture, the microvilli of apical membrane is present in case of serous cells. Such microvilli of apical membrane are absent in mucous cells. Then intercellular canaliculi, the tight junctions and the foldings of the cell membrane are present in the serous acinus. Such features are absent in the mucous acinus. So these are the differences between the serous acinus and the mucous acinus. So to summarize, the histological features of parotid gland, submandibular gland and sublingual gland, all these glands consist of two main components, that is the stroma and parenchyma. Stroma is a connective tissue component and it consists of capsule and connective tissue septa. And these connective tissue septa carry ducts and blood vessels. In case of sublingual gland, the capsule is indefined. Clear? Then in the parenchyma of parotid gland, there are acini and ducts. Now, in case of parotid gland, the acini are serous acini. And these acini are surrounded by myoepithelial cells. And the ducts are striated ducts and intercalated ducts. So within the parenchyma, there are acini, there are serous acini and two types of ducts, striated ducts and intercalated ducts. In addition to that, there are few adipose tissues. In case of submandibular gland, the parenchyma consists of both acini because it is a mixed salivary gland. Parotid gland is a serous salivary gland. Submandibular gland is a mixed salivary gland. It consists of both acini. That means there are serous acini and mucous acini, but the submandibular gland consists of serous acini, predominantly serous acini. Then in addition to acini, there are striated ducts. These are striated ducts and intercalated ducts. This is intercalated duct, this is the striated duct. Then the sublingual gland, it is also a mixed salivary gland but predominantly mucous acini. Therefore it is also known as mucous salivary gland. So here you can see the all are mucous acini and very few serous acini. Then as it is a mixed salivary gland, you can see the serous demilunes. In the submandibular gland also there are serous demilunes. Then in sublingual gland, the striated ducts and intercalated ducts are very few or sometimes absent. So these are the features of histological features of parotid, submandibular and sublingual gland. Thank you.